Why would you want to be with a blind woman? To say we are warmly received by George, who has a sight impairment himself, and his staff, is an understatement, as the office comes to a standstill on our arrival. The Score Foundation is a nationwide trust offering information through its telephone helpline, the first in India, and its website, iWay. A radio programme is also aired, something akin to BBC Radio 4's In Touch in England. And the Foundation handles emails, letters and telephone calls from all over the country, questions relating to employment, education, discrimination and legal matters. The office sits underground, down several flights of dark stairs, and compared to UK organisations, the contrast is stark. Little seems wasted on imposing edifices, as every rupee is directed towards services. Settling deeper into chairs for a long interview about the journey, life, the universe and everything around blindness, an hour later, we find the interview was not recorded. The sounds of our laughter can be heard through the office on finding out that, perhaps, two sight-impaired people may have needed a little assistance to make sure the correct record button was pressed. Over the next few days, George and Siddharth Sharma put together a schedule of engagements for us. Siddharth lost his sight in a motorcycle accident as he drove into a black-painted barrier at night, which the police had helpfully placed across the road at face height. Hitting it, his vision ended with the impact. Nobody was ever held to account for the stupidity of such an act, and compensation is a land of distant dreams for ordinary people caught up in such things in India. Thus, Sid, as everybody calls him, was left to salvage what he could from his new life in the dark. Meeting George when the first World Blind Cricket Cup was being organised, he became involved in the promotion of the event, and his talent for PR was discovered. The engagements Sid and George arranged for us involve visits to various organisations and interviews with New Delhi TV, India's major channel, and the largest paper, the Hindustan Times. Early the next morning, a car arrived from the TV station for our first live interview to be broadcast at 8 a.m. Listening to the news, I'm struck by all the stories of robberies, car crashes, and the impact of financial meltdown on India. It feels like home, in an Indian way. The presenters use our journey as a contrast to all the bad news, noting that occasionally there are good stories, stories about everyday people doing extraordinary things. It's strange to think of the millions of people watching their TV, while our images flicker across the screens, as we talk of the wish to show people that, yes, there is so much a blind person can do. It takes faith, both in yourself and others. I'm lucky, having both of these things. From the TV studios, another car takes us to the Delhi Boys School, where a wonderful morning passes with pupils fascinated by the concept of a blind woman going around the world on a motorcycle. I was very touched and humbled to be asked to present the Achievement Awards at the Assembly. And it was a very moving experience when you think of the hardships people have in this huge country. Life is hard here for many people, but to be blind is to make it so much harder still. When the children sing at the end of the Assembly, I listen to 100 voices accompanied by a young boy playing the harmonium feet away from where I stand. A distinctive and Indian sound. Bernard will forever remember the walk from the headmaster's office to the assembly hall, when the headmaster took his hand to lead us both through the building. In the hall itself, Bernard takes pictures of the proceedings, and later on it is apparent something has been lost in the translation. The headmaster thought Bernard was partially sighted, Bernard, meanwhile, thought the headmaster was just being friendly. In the afternoon, the celebrity reporter I.T. Dewan of The Times talks about our thoughts and experiences across the journey before settling on to Pakistan. In all sincerity, we answer that the Pakistani people were fantastic, but can't drive, and were very kind during our journey. It was a very good interview, and so funny, as Bernard recalled managing to pass industrial-sized condom machines without actually seeing them in a German hotel in Kosovo. The afternoon is very poignant at the Centre for Blind Women, where 20 women ask us a huge range of questions. Their curiosity knows no bounds, and it was very sad to listen to their stories about what it means to be blind and a woman in India. Questions fly at us about relationships, and many questions were directed at Bernard and how a sighted person feels about a blind partner. The centre manager had prepared us for this by talking about the culture in India, which frowns on a sighted, non-sighted relationship. The group is totally fascinated by Bernard and our relationship. The single most important question they ask Bernard is, "Men do not want you if you are blind. Why would you want to be with a blind woman?" I feel Bernard pause as he thinks before responding. "If you knew Cathy, you would not have to ask the question." The women break into spontaneous applause. Nina speaks of how her husband promptly divorced her when her eyesight started to fail through the onset of retinitis pigmentosa, as she was now of little use to him. I felt both sad for her and grateful for myself that my world is so different, despite us having the same condition. As she talks of her painful separation and of being cast off, I was mindful that it is only when you meet such differences that you realise how thankful you should be for your own life. When she'd finished telling us of her experiences, Bernard asked if she knew what RP really stood for. She shook her head, shyly. "RP can also stand for really pretty." Her face lit up, and colour spread through her cheeks, blushing furiously as her friends laugh and clap loudly. Hearing stories of young girls losing their sight through undiagnosed glaucoma, of being confined within family homes with no prospects of a career or of forming relationships, it's so hard to listen. Their lives are summed up or reduced down to being a poor match for marriage, still largely arranged. And of all the visits, this was the one Bernard was most affected by. How the girls desperately just wanted to know there was somebody out there for them. As we talk about being blind, my own past, and the fact that Bernard is not my first sighted husband, I recount how I ended up alone and unsure about the future. With the loss of my husband Peter after 19 years of marriage, it was possible for me to reinvent myself through education. Thus I met Bernard and arrived in India, riding on the back of his motorcycle. The overriding message I tried to send to them was a simple one, that sometimes life presents you with an opportunity. They may be few and far between, but they're always there at some point and should be grabbed with both hands. Never be frightened of change, as you never know where it will lead or when the next chance will come along. While our conversations explored many different directions, covering things such as how it's possible to live alone as a blind person, guide dogs and travelling alone, the underlying question always returned: relationships and the need to have someone in their lives. It came across very powerfully throughout our time at the centre, and it left us both very sad and much moved. The extent of need in the room was palpable. We could feel it encircling us. powerful, emotional yearning. The centre manager later told us that in India, these women are doubly disabled, for they are both blind and women. It's a very powerful statement from a person who knows far more than we do what it means to experience sight loss in this economic engine room of the world. Leaving the centre very subdued, Nina was etched firmly into both our hearts. Over the following days, many different institutions and providers of support, advice and hope for people with sight loss show us how hard life can be, and it leads into a very wide-ranging radio interview. George returns to the level of support received from UK organisations for the blind in the preparation for the journey and while on the road. He shakes his head in puzzlement at our two-year struggle to gain any support at all before leaving the country. "If it had been here, I would have had you riding with Bollywood stars on national TV, and the papers would have had you everywhere. There is no doubt they would have all been fighting each other to do it," he announces. His sentiment leaves us, this time, shaking our heads in agreement at the opportunities lost. Exploring my early life as a young girl growing up with failing eyesight, my experiences in specialist and mainstream schools are trawled, along with the time traversing the 14 countries so far. Finishing the interview, George tells me it will be broadcast as a special, in its entirety, as it's too good to cut down, too funny. As the daylight ends, Sid invites us to visit Rahul, who has recently returned to India after 14 years in Mozambique, and who later that evening invites us to stay at his home. Thinking about it for at least 2 seconds before accepting, our belongings are packed from a completely trashed hotel room. Outside, Rahul stands with many others as our spaceship is readied for launch. He explains my blindness to nearby people, along with the purpose of our journey, as a man comments, "In India, he wouldn't marry her. Never mind take her round the world on a motorbike." Sadly, the sentence sums up everything people have told us of what it means to be a blind woman in India. Moving into Rahul's, we spend our evenings talking with Sid and Rahul, sharing our thoughts and perceptions about everything experienced. It's good to talk to Sid, as I sometimes feel Indian blind people are very isolated, having little, if any, opportunity to talk through feelings, barriers and problems they encounter. In England, I have been very fortunate to live a balanced life, having many friends who are blind and also many who have sight. I've never believed that a blind person should exist in either or, because it limits and restricts opportunities to live a full and complete life. Some visually impaired people spend most of their time among the blind and partially sighted, and have little opportunity for personal interaction with sighted people. In India, I'm not sure if it's possible to live such a balanced life, as opportunities for independent movement are so restricted. Neither Sid nor George use a long cane, but rely totally on sighted assistance, largely due to the environment. On talking to Sid, he says if you turn in any direction in India, you will find someone to help you. With a population of 1.2 billion, this is hardly surprising. Indeed, Sid has what Rahul calls a Man Friday, full-time domestic help. In India, this is a way of life for many, as labour is so cheap. If you have a reasonable income, everybody seems to have live-in servants. Sid asks about daily life at home, my gadgets to aid me in daily living, things such as a colour identifier, which helps me match clothes. Long conversations take place about using Braille, which he gave up in frustration, never being able to develop the speed to make it really useful. I too understand this frustration, as I learnt it much later in life, resulting in a much slower speed in reading and writing. Even after many years of using Braille, I'm a tortoise compared to many of my friends who learnt it as a child, when I could still see something. In many ways, I'd rejected Braille as a teenager, as it was for blind people. I was not blind. Even when teachers tried to tell me it would be useful, I refused to contemplate learning it. It was for blind people. As a teenage girl staring at the world through misty, failing eyes, I would have none of it. Failing eyesight makes you run and hide from the truth, and it was years before I understood what my teachers had tried to tell me. Braille is a weapon in the armoury of tools. Perhaps the saying, "You cannot put an old head on young shoulders," will always be true. Over the days, Rahul and Sid look after us as we come to understand nuances of Indian life, culture and history. As I wander in and out of shops to explore clothes, jewellery and artefacts of Indian culture, I have to buy something, even though Bernard witters on about the lack of space. As always, he relents in a small Tibetan shop, where a necklace becomes mine for the princely sum of 250 rupees, or under £3. Sitting and eating muffins and drinking vanilla smoothies, the hustle and bustle of the roadside passes by. Visiting the famous Red Fort, my fingers trace the long history of the Mughal Empire and the subsequent invasion by the British, who stripped many aspects of the fort's ornate and beautifully crafted gold leaf decorations. Prising them from the walls with bayonets, all that remains are black stains showing the remnants of glue. Many people became very rich when they returned to England to sell off a part of history. On our final day in Delhi, we lunch with George Abraham, his wife Rupa, and youngest daughter Tara, and talk turns to our onward journey to the Taj Mahal. On hearing of our next destination, we set off across Delhi with his wife's car horn blowing her way through the traffic, telling us how her horn was once broken and she could not drive the car for days. It amuses Bernard. Ending up in a shop, a very lovely marble model of the Taj Mahal is placed in my hands to explore, later bought for me as a gift by George and his wife. A further package is sent home, containing all the leaflets and booklets accumulated on our travels, along with Bernard's leather jacket, given as a gift by the Istanbul agent, Jem, who once hoped to buy a bike himself. Years later, the jacket still hung in his wardrobe, waiting for the arrival of the bike. Then Bernard arrived, and the jacket was released from the confines of the darkened space. Carefully folded, a treasured memento, it's packed into the third box sent home so far. The morning of leaving seems strange as we gather outside Rahul's, sad to leave, but knowing it's time to move on. We can feel it. Bertha calls from where she's parked, and her voice hasn't been heard for days now. Also, we haven't slept well due to the incessant traffic noise filling the night air, with car horns blaring constantly. As a blind person, the city is a wall of noise, and it can be very startling, tiring and disorienting. Setting off alone down the road, it feels good and bad to be on the move again. After several days of rest, everything seems harder. The cars seem closer, the horns seem louder, the braking of Bertha heavier. The bike moves far more than I remember. Meanwhile, people blast past us in a wave of horns inches away from my legs. Crawling through the multiple jams, I hear people talking through car windows, so close are they. Bernard is quiet. I know he's struggling to adapt, to find a way through the frantic chaos. With fingers crossed, we struggle out of Delhi unscathed, until eventually finding ourselves on the road to Agra, the home of the Taj Mahal.